Just for a change of pace, I'm going to try a repair on camera here. I was charging up these nickel metal hydride batteries with this nickel metal hydride battery charger, which should be a no-brainer, should work just fine, and I've done it dozens of times before. But as I was sitting there at the computer beside this thing, I heard a nasty snap, crackle, pop kind of noise come out of it, and if you could stick your nose close to the camera, close to the computer, your screen, whatever you're watching this on, you might be able to smell the nasty burning smell out of this thing. If you have the proper smell-o-vision adapter on your device. Anyway, so let's tear this sucker apart and see what went boom. First thing I notice is it's got these little triangular fasteners here. Fortunately, this kit here comes with weird security screws. So, like the triangles, 2mm and 2.2. That's a little bit loosey-goosey. There it is. Okay, so let's get in here and see what we got. At least it's not glued in or something. I'm not quite sure what I'm expecting to find blowed up. Yeah, I really don't know. This thing, does it say how old it is? 06F24. Maybe it's 2006? I could use my spudgers. Okay, why does that want to come apart? Come out. Is there a hidden screw in here somewhere? No, it doesn't look like it. Okay. Is there some kind of a latch or catch down there? Or is it just all these little spring latches? What the hell? Oh. Little flaky bit of, let's push that over into the middle of the frame. Don't know what that is. That's interesting. Why doesn't that want to come apart? Oh ho ho. Is there? There's the culprit. The hidden screw. Okay. Aha, we're in. Ooh. What are you? Dried flakiness. Wonder if that's left over from maybe an older battery that got cooked in this thing years ago. Yeah, that's not the most pleasant thing. Okay. Zoomity zoom. So let's look for obvious things that have exploded. Not seeing anything super obvious. How's that come out of there? Okay. Oh, okay. Oh! Well, there's a telltale sign. And there's some more telltale sign. Let's get in closer and take a peek here. Focus. So, oh, there is a separation slot. Okay, so this is going to be your basic switch mode power supply. There's the opto-isolator between the high voltage side and low voltage side to get feedback. So AC is coming in these two red wires over there, P1 and P2. Four diodes, obvious bridge rectifier. What's that little red knob there? I'm going to guess probably something in the realm of an inductor, maybe. Why can't I keep that in frame? I should zoom back a little bit more. That'll help me. Okay. So what's down in around the sparkiness here? This is just a nylon, or of course nylon bristle brush, and it's going to clean that up just a little bit so I can see what's happened. And I am going to zoom back in as tight as I can just to use the camera phone as a magnifying glass. Kind of looks like that trace is blown right off the board, doesn't it? But why? What else do I have here that I can scrub it with? Actually, I think I'll dab a bit of alcohol. Dabber bottle here. Dab a little alcohol into there. Just to try and clean some of the soot off. Let's see. Yeah. So I can see what's going on under there. Okay. Now, magnify. Wondering if there's just a stray bit of something or they got in there, or if the corrosion that was left over from, like I said, a while back, some old batteries kind of leaked, and wonder if some of that they just corroded away. Some of the copper, and it migrated. Hang on. I might try and get my magnifying glass out and just get my own eyes in there. Closer, because that looks to me. Okay, I am going to try this with the camera lens and my magnifier together. Ooh, this is difficult. So that trace looks to me like it should go up there. And there's a connection there. It looks like it blew across to that one, doesn't it? Hang on for a second here. So this trace comes along here. Just made a 90 bend, nice gentle 90 bend up to there. But, and it's not supposed to contact with that pad, but it looks like it arced across for reasons unknown. And just blew that up. This trace here doesn't even have a pad on it. What you're seeing is just the peeled up copper. Wow. So, come back out just a little bit. So what is that component right there? Okay, so these three pins in a row here are windings on the transformer. See, they're a nice straight line, and that's the high voltage side of the transformer, and this is up there, and this is the low voltage side of the transformer down here. These two are the low voltage side of the opto-isolator. These two are the high voltage side of the opto-isolator, or the primary or main side, and these are the isolated. Yeah, that's probably a better way of saying it. This is the mains side, and this is the isolated from the mains side. So, not sure I want to dick with that too much, especially since it's on the mains side. But, no guts, no glory. What's the worst that could happen? I'm going to get out my soldering iron. I'm going to clean that area up with something a bit more aggressive than the nylon brush. I'm going to rebuild that trace with just a piece of thin wire, because it's a very thin trace. It's not that high current. And then I'll come back and we'll see what happens. So after a bunch of cleaning and scraping, it seems to me this trace, as I said, went past here. There's a bit of white paint just to insulate it from this, and of course a gap, kind of like this and this, just indicating that there's a gap. But that came around up and onto there. But this is part of this big pad, which connects to there and there and there. So why did it come around and up here rather than just going into there? This is, like I said, on the line side, the main side of the isolation gap. So that's... I wonder if that little chip there is creating the high frequency to, yeah, I bet that's what that guy is. And just pause for a second again and look him up. Okay, so that chip is TNY264. Which is a switching regulator, switching power supply chip, as I sort of suspected. Here's the data sheet. Does it talk about... So, pin 7 and 8 are the high voltage. Drain two sources. Enable and a BP. Enable, bypass, drain. Okay. There we go. So... let's see if we can find out in here. Oscillator, 132 kilohertz. That's what I was looking for. So that's not a ridiculously high frequency. I mean, it's, where is it? It's, and it's low RF, I guess. AM broadcast band is 540 kilohertz. So here's the application circuit, which is probably not all that different from a good chunk of what's going on in my little charger. The AC input, fusible resistor, four diodes, series choke on the one side of that, couple of parallel capacitors just to smooth that guy out. And then we hit our magic little chip here, which excites the primary of the transformer. There's where that that gap on the circuit board cuts through there and cuts through there across the optoisolator. Zener diode on the, no, Schottky diode, sorry, on the output. So on the secondary side of that transformer. Class Y capacitor, yeah, I can see some of those. And then just out to the regulated voltage output set by this Zener down here. That stuff is a little bit different on my charger. Then there is a charge control type chip and a temperature sensor and a few other things downstream over here. But that's essentially what it is. It's a fairly straightforward little power supply chip. So having convinced myself that wasn't a high frequency transmission line, that it was in fact just a normal trace, I have decided to replace it with just a piece of just a single conductor out of a Cat 5 cable. So just tin him up a little bit. Try not to burn my fingers too badly. Try not to set fire to my cutting mat. And I'll just solder that in place. Now I know there's going to be people screaming, "No, don't do it, you'll burn your house down." I'm not planning on putting this thing back into production. This is just a can I do this repair. Is this going to actually work? So there's that soldered in. Yes, it is kind of violating the air gap there between the primary and secondary side. But I'm not concerned. Like I said, this isn't going to go back into service. I'm just dicking around here trying to see if I can fix it. So, meanwhile, what is that charge controller chip, I wonder? Let's see if I can find
I looked up that 14-pin chip, and I was wrong about the part number. It actually is a CD4541B by Texas Instruments, which matches the labeling exactly on it. And it's not a charge controller. It's a timer. So this thing doesn't actually sense the charge current and shut off it when it's done. It just runs for a certain amount of time by the looks of it. The board's kind of got enough corrosion and pollution on it that it's really hard to trace what's going on. But I just thought I'd clarify that. And the general pinout matches what's shown here, even down to pin 4 and 11 not being used. So, yeah, there it is.
Okay, there it is. Let's see what happens. That's a good sign. Let's see if there's any voltage across these. There is. Or how about across the triple A? Okay, 7 volts across there. So from there to 1.4. Okay, so there is voltage available there, and it is DC. Okay. And it's not making any sparky noises. That's a good sign. Okay, I'm going to get a little bit more dangerous here. But not too dangerous. Turn that off while I'm messing around in here. What, you think I'm stupid? So, what I've done is I've just balanced precariously the two AAA batteries in between the holders where they normally would go. Normally they would be mechanically held in there, but this is just kind of balanced between the electrical contacts. I'm not powered on yet, and I've got I've got clip leads on either end of this battery. This one, because I couldn't get on there nice, I've just got a little bead magnet on there holding on, and I've got my meter on here. So I've got one, so that battery right now, I'm just measuring the battery, and it's sitting at 1.3 volts. It was being charged when this thing blowed up. So if I turn it on, the voltage sneaks up a little bit, 1.32, 1.33, and this LED down here, so let's turn some light off. I think you can see that it's on. Let me just turn that. Yeah, so that's the charge indicator. I'm not going to get my fingers too close in here, but I think that's working. So I think my initial hypothesis is correct, that a long time ago a battery died. You can and spewed its guts out. You can see there's a little bit of corrosion down there, and some corrosion on that contact, and even a little bit down there, and that dissolved some of the copper on the back of the board and created a path where it could arc over. That's my theory. I'm sticking with it. As I also said earlier, just because I've got this thing working again doesn't mean I'm going to put it back into service. That's just a janky little fix. It would probably work, but I wouldn't want to leave it running unattended. There's still a lot of corrosion on the back of the board. That corrosion's probably got a lot of dissolved copper put into stupid places, which could be really, really dangerous. So I'm going to scrap that and go and buy another charger. I might actually get one off of China. Or, since these batteries are IKEA, maybe I'll go to IKEA and see what they've got. Because I trust the Swedes more than I trust the Chinese with stuff that I'm actually plugging into AC power. Anyway, hope that was slightly interesting. I found it interesting going through that. I will talk to you later.